Welcome everyone to the Investigator Skills Development Unit monthly webinar as part of the Multiple Chronic Diseases Disparities Research Consortium, which very soon will be rebranded as the Health Equity Action Network. The website for the consortium will be going live, we think, within the next week, and we will be distributing that information and site to everybody. So welcome. Rochelle, any last minute administrative things we need to deal with?
I don't believe so.
Before we dive in. Great, so Rochelle and Adele will be monitoring the chat if you have questions, and let's dive right in. So good morning, I'm Dr. Edwin Charlebois. I'm the director of the UCSF Research Coordinating Center to Reduce Disparities in Multiple Chronic Diseases for our NIMHD Research Consortium. I'm also the director of our postdoctoral traineeship and AIDS prevention studies and co-director of our methods core here at the Center for AIDS Prevention Studies. So today we wanted to, as part of our skills development unit activities within the consortium, we wanted to talk about and give some tips on effective scientific poster creation and presentation. So my goals for today are to share my 30 plus years of experience in creating and presenting posters and in coaching and guiding poster work by grad students, postdocs, and early career faculty. I'd like to provide some recommendations and tips from our joint experience on how to create effective scientific posters, how to design them well, how to present them well, and to point you to some useful resources for learning more, because we're not going to be able to get everything you need in one 40-minute setting. So I thought it would be helpful to go over scientific posters and their role in your early career stages, a little bit on effective visual communication and adult learning styles that I found useful in developing posters, a few tips on presenting your poster, and some guidelines for scientific poster design that I found really, really useful in the past. And then some more recent developments, modifications for developing posters and presenting now that we're in the COVID era, for posters that are to be done and presented online, and also virtual poster presentation. And then relevant to some work that we're gonna be doing here within our consortium, I wanted to present the concept poster variant, and then open it up for questions and discussions. I'm hoping we can get through this within 40 minutes and leave a fair amount of time for questions and discussion. So, you know, there are many resources out there on the web on poster design and creation. You know, most of them say the same thing in various different ways. Some of them are a little bit contradictory. So, for brevity's sake, my favorite is Colin Purington's webpage, which is a very succinct list of 40 do's and don'ts. And he also presents some poster templates for you. So if you wanted to go like a one-stop rapid digest of recommendations for poster creation and presentation, Colin Purington's site's a really good one. Also on the web, there are a number of different poster templates that you can download in PowerPoint format. There are lots of pictures of scientific posters from a number of research arenas. I really encourage you to go on the web and look around and look at different poster presentations and content and see what resonates with you, and also as an idea generating activity. A lot of the large national and international meetings now have a conference poster archives. That's another great resource to go and investigate and look at, because there's nothing like modeling on success. Look at what's out there, look at what's won, and familiarize yourself with what good scientific posters look like. I'm also going to recommend a book and a couple of journal articles and one online course that I've found really helpful to me. So we know you're all very busy with your research projects and training. You know, why would you want to expend effort on making and presenting a poster? Well, scientific posters, I think, are really a key skills development activity early in your career. Learning how to write a scientific conference abstract is a fantastic and very necessary skill. How to organize your thoughts, present your research questions, get results across succinctly and forming well-supported conclusions. That abstract writing skill set will serve you throughout your career in not only scientific poster and meeting presentations, but it's a critical skill for grant writing, for paper writing. And so the activities that you put into this early career activity of creating and scientific posters is a really, really beneficial. But we're not going to cover abstract writing. That's actually a topic all to itself that we'll probably do as another webinar in the future. But today we're going to focus mostly on poster and creating an effective poster design. You know, presenting posters in your early career is part of this natural progression within scientific conferences and consortium like ours. You know, learning how to design a poster, then actually giving a poster talk, and that those skill sets lead directly into the day when you're actually going to be standing up in front of a stage of 1,000 people giving an oral presentation. You know, so I think this is it may seem like one more thing that you have to do, or like, do you really want to spend my time doing this? I really encourage you to share your work and your results through scientific posters and poster presentation, because it's a fantastic vehicle to develop your own communication skills and style that are going to serve you throughout your career. Some of the early experience that you get in presenting your poster and speaking to broader scientific peers will serve you very well in terms of making connections with people who you're going to run into later in your career. And also, you know, unlike just putting out a journal article or something on a website, there's something about presenting a poster in person and interacting with people. I think my experience and those of my trainees has been that those exchanges of describing and presenting your poster really can lead to some unique and new information, things that you hadn't necessarily thought of. It's like, oh, I didn't think about that, or oh yeah, I should be more clear around this. The other benefit is that scientific posters and abstracts are often archived and available. Sometimes they're published in compendia, and they really count as evidence of research productivity. And as I mentioned earlier, networking opportunities, and I'll get into that a little bit more. So what's out there that can help with poster design? For me, in my early career, I learned a little bit about adult learning styles that aided me in poster design. And I'm going to talk about some modifications of that I gleaned from teaching, a little bit on visual communication skills and guidelines. And then since I'm married to a PR professional, I wanted to give you some basics that I've been gifted with about from communication professionals. So one of the initial things that really helped me in designing posters and presenting in general was learning a little bit about the science of adult learning. So there's some research and a lot of educational dogma that says that children and adults differ in regard to the mode of learning that's most effective for them. And so there are three kind of main schools around these learning styles, but the most predominant one is this one that posits that there are three main learning modes. One is visual. People people incorporate information visually. They want to see it. They want to see how things are arranged or organized. Auditory. Some people have preferences for they want to hear. They want to hear from you and stories or information that way. And then kinesthetic. And there are extensions on those that have been used. You can see in the lower left-hand corner here some of those extensions: linguistics, logical learners, interpersonal, etc. In truth, nobody has just one learning style. You're often have a combination of those. And more recently, I think the field is moving the direction that there's not a lot of scientific evidence that these learning styles really significantly matter in terms of outcomes. So the randomized trials and things are really not showing much of an effect, which is amazing because learning styles are such a large part of the educational system. So given that caveat, early in my career, I found it helpful in the setting of getting information across to people in a very short manner of time. So the science does show that among adult learners, there are very specific preferences. So very in the modes at which people would like information presented to them. And from a poster session where people are fairly rushed for time, I think understanding these adult learning styles and the modalities attached to them can help you in designing your poster. For me, from my work and working with students and in my actual day-to-day teaching, I've kind of modified these. I find that when I'm talking about presenting information to people, I break them down into four categories. The first is graphical, diagrams showing processes or steps or how things are related to one another is good. I'm a very list-based person myself. So bulleted lists of information is a way to get complex and detailed information across very quickly has been effective. Things that are more prosaic, people who want to, there are sometimes you really want to present something for clarity's sake as, a full and complete sentence. So, textual based things. And lastly, contextual presentation. So story-based or presenting the context of something, why things matter, how things interact with each other. And that's from my qualitative colleagues, I've moved much more into the mixed methods arena. But the take home from all of that, that in my early experience and the way you get information across to people is that I think it's important to incorporate different presentation elements and modes into your poster. Graphics, list-based information, where you can, contextual, qualitative quotes. And so just in order to potentially address those different preferences that people have for how to get information understood quickly, having that mixture, I think, leads to a better poster and a more effective scientific poster. Posters are primarily, primarily a visual, a visual medium. So one of the questions is like how to be an effective visual communicator. So a couple of things early in my career that were useful were a couple of books and one course. One of the most influential books for me was The Visual Display of Quantitative Information by Edward Tufte. He's kind of known as the guru of scientific visual communication. There are so many bad figures and graphs and diagrams out there, and there aren't really many good avenues to learn how to how to choose the best graph, how to create the best graph, how to create an informative diagram to explain a very, very complex endeavor. And I found that Edward Tufte's book was fantastic about that. Even better, he holds a one-day course that now in the era of COVID is actually an online course That was really a fantastic companion to his books, including the Visual Display of Quantitative Information. I highly recommend looking at that. The course is a little expensive. It's over $100, but there are discounts for graduate students. And the nice part is if you actually take that course, you get five of his books, including these very pivotal texts as part of that course. Also useful is Donna Wong's Wall Street Journal Guide to Information Graphics, I find that also a very useful resource. From the graphic design world, there are recognized rules and guidelines that are very applicable to poster design. Here are kind of the 10 commandments of visual communication. I found that learning about some of these principles has really improved my own poster design, my recommendations, and helping people edit and create theirs. So learning a little bit about the principles of visual communication is helpful. And when we make these slides available, people we'll have a number of resources. I can point you to some websites for that. But starting on the left, one of the first commandments is, thou shalt understand the color wheel and color theory. And I found this useful in choosing colors for posters, the idea of complementary colors, things that look good together and yet provide contrast, analogous colors, trying to highlight things using analogous colors is used when things are somewhat related to each other and you don't want to create that much contrast. But there's a lot in color theory that I think applies to the visual display of information that we use. Moving on, I found it useful to understand a little bit more about typography and read on some of the recommendations and guidelines, understanding font families and the rules that go along with those, it's important to combine fonts of complementary moods, never use two different fonts from the same general family. There are some other general guidelines. We know that sans serif fonts are those that are fairly clean, don't have any ends. One of the things that I learned that I'm still trying to incorporate, it's great in posters and in visual presentations to mix a sans serif font with a serif font. Also, kind of not what you would think, but the serif fonts, that have these ends are actually much more useful when you're dealing with smaller text size. That's one of the reasons why books are you don't see a lot of sans serif fonts used in books. So it's useful to understand a little bit more about typography, how to use different weights, bolds, thins, shadows, and things like that. So I found that useful as well. Other visual principles that come into play with poster creation or understanding hierarchy, the use of lines to point things out, to demarcate things. Don't be afraid to use some iconography. We're all very familiar with things like with stop signs or exclamation points. The only caveat there is be careful and parsimonious in your use of icons. You still want to maintain an air of professionality. So having a poster rife with emojis is probably may turn several people off. Other visual design principles, such as contrast, order, and weights are good skills to develop. And lastly, of these 10 commandments, I think one of the things that's also very useful is this idea about space and less is more. For poster creation, I think one of the top 10 problematic issues is that people trying to pack every amount of open space in a poster, with information and content. And that often can work against you in attracting people to your poster and also just your ability to comprehend what people are trying to get across. So Having a fair amount of open space and breaks between things in a poster is both visually pleasing and cognitively easier to digest. And then a couple of basics from communication professionals that I've found and very useful and want to recommend to you. I think top on that list is know your audience. You know, who is it that this poster is aimed at? Is it aimed at, is it a conference of people who are fairly conversant with the topic that you're talking about? That has implications in terms of how much jargon you can use, how many acronyms. In general, I try and suggest to people that where possible, you avoid jargon, unless it's something that's really well known within your field. Another part of knowing your audience is think about how a poster is actually absorbed. And you'll see from some of the photographs I'm gonna be sharing, if you haven't ever been to a poster presentation before, but there are rows and rows of these posters side by side, and there's a throng of people walking along and looking at them. So some research has shown that you get more engagement from people who are standing as opposed to sitting and listening to a talk. But I think there are caveats in the actual physical presentation of posters that you have to pay attention to: height, how far away you are, et cetera. So know your audience, know what their interests are, what might attract them, those sorts of things. In terms of content, the communications professionals tell us over and over, be clear, concise, and consistent. Only include the information that's needed. Stay on message. And we've all heard of public product focus groups and pre-marketing. The same thing applies for posters. And I've got here, you have pre-test and revise. Like, don't be afraid to have multiple versions of your poster. Share it with your colleagues. Get frank feedback and work your way through multiple versions. That's been one of the more useful activities engaged in poster design. And then thinking a little bit about what we present on posters, I think it's helpful to think about the differences between how our mindset as a researcher and the consumer of information. As researchers, we have a very set way of thinking about things and writing. What's the background of the problem? What are the supporting details? How are you doing at things? Give me the results and conclusions. From the consumer standpoint, which as a participant in a scientific meeting and you're walking in a poster hall, you are a consumer of information. Often those priorities are flipped. When you're walking along and looking at a poster, I find myself more interested in, like, what's the bottom line here? What's the answer? So I'm kind of more interested in that, because that's what's gonna draw or attract me into something. And then the questions around, like, so what? And then I want to know, okay, well, how did you actually come to that conclusion? So there's this inverse relationship between how we as researchers normally think about things, and in the setting of a poster presentation, what a consumer is looking for. And I think it's great to keep those things in mind. So those are just some of the general principles that I've and areas I think for you to educate yourself that I've found and can suggest will be helpful in creating and designing your poster. Now, as I've said, there are a lot of guidelines out there for scientific poster design. I gave you a link for one of my favorites. They also include templates and things like that. So let's dive into it. Let's dive into the guidelines for scientific poster design that I want to suggest. Here they are at a glance, just as text and bullets, kind of hard to pull those things out at a glance. Well, part of designing a poster is, how do you take something, a list of something and information you want to get across, and in a visually effective and intelligible way. So let's dive right in. My first recommendation is is to make your poster readable from 3 to 5 feet away. That's really how far people, the majority of people, are going to be when they first encounter your poster. And so what that means is, you know, definitely use large font sizes for titles, for material that you presenting in your various sections. Use an appropriate large font size. This is one of the deadliest sins that poster creators can make, is having a poster with minuscule text that you really can't read from far away, and overloading a poster with text. It's almost impossible. As you can see in this upper right-hand corner, you know, some posters actually attract quite a crowd. And it's, if you can't get at least some of the critical information standing that far away, you've lost your opportunity to communicate what you're doing. I also suggest, if you can and where possible, having a large eye-catching graphic or diagram. That often I have found that will draw people in, as opposed to a poster that is really, really text heavy. Second recommendation is, take advantage of the full display space. It's often a crime to run across a poster that is really tiny and hard to read as you're jockeying for position, and you realize that they could have actually made that much bigger, made it much more readable and much more accessible to a large group of people. So definitely check the conference poster information that you're attending. They'll often give you the size of the board that you have to take advantage of. So really, really pay attention to that. And one thing I've noticed in some of these guidelines, and I've seen happen actually in a conference poster hall, is people disparaging some presentations like this one here in the lower middle. And I just ask that we all remember and be respectful. I work in a lot of resource limited settings, and not everyone who attends these conferences is equally resourced. So just remember, sometimes you'll see posters that are really slick, and it's clear that the institutions that supported them, had professionals help them with. But for some of us, that's the first time, we've been at a conference, and we're coming from a situation where we're lucky if we have access to a color printer. So just remember to be respectful that not everyone is equally resourced. I think, hope fervently that you don't have a vertical poster format. This is one of my pet peeves of conferences, and it's happened to several of my conferences where they've switched over to these vertical poster displays. And it's really tough, both graphically and design-wise. It's, as you can see here in the middle, Colin Purrington points this out. It's really terrible if you have to stoop down to try and get information off of a poster. This poster here on the right is actually one of my posters from the earliest part of my career. It was actually a poster from one of my first clinical trials. So there are some things about it that make me cringe, knowing what I know now, but it's not terrible. There are clearly demarcated sections. There were some okay, but monochromatic color choices. There are definitely things I would have done differently, and I hope to share some of those with you. Rochelle, I saw you had a hand up.
Yeah, I just thought this might be a time to pop in with one quick question. Someone was asking if you have specific font sizes that you recommend.
There are recommendations out there, but it's really dependent on the area that you're allowed to have. I think rather than a font size number, I think that guideline to is it readable from 3 to 5 feet away, when it's going to be at that size. If you look in Colin's information, there are some, 32, 46, but it's because everything has to be proportional to the display size. It's hard to give that, as a set a set guideline around font sizes. But I think the general rules, much larger than you're comfortable with and are used to. So, you know, if whatever you're used to, at least double it. Take a look at the posters that are out there and look at the spatial organization of readable text and headings. And I think that will and then look at your own poster and see if it's roughly equivalent to those. And I think that could give you an idea of if you're in the right ballpark. One of my other recommendations is to use informative and engaging titles. As you're, you know, from the consumer standpoint, as I'm walking through a poster hall, I'm looking at the titles, and you know, the titles matter. So those titles that are more interesting, those titles that actually tell me something, are ones that will attract me to go over and look at it a little more. So active titles, I find, that give findings are much more engaging. Going back to that very, that early poster of my own, here's an original title, results of a randomized clinical trial of blah, 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 you know, so it's like, okay, you're more telling me about generally what it's about and more about the process. If I were to do that today, I would have done it very differently. I would have used an active title. I would have, you know, had the title tell me something that was much more engaging. You know, home-based HIV VCT is superior to TB clinic-based VCT, you know, for successful testing of family and household members. That's, for me, that's much more engaging. I'd want to go and take a look at that. I don't usually recommend putting too many acronyms in your title. Here's another situation where knowing your field and knowing your audience is important. If it's a meeting where everyone is completely familiar with that, you know, I don't need to spell out human immunodeficiency virus. And in this particular meeting, VCT is just a common abbreviation that we would all use. So definitely where you can, make your titles engaging and actually tell you something. It's often, in my suggestions with my students, I'm having them take something, their primary conclusion. It's like, can you work your conclusion in? And this applies to abstract titles, applies to paper titles. I think I find this to be a useful suggestion. In general, in the guidelines that are out there, what to include on your poster, it usually follows what was in your submitted app, your abstract. You know, that's typically, you know, put in a, the guidelines are, you know, put in a copy of your abstract, then do the introduction background, materials and methods, results, conclusions, then some references and acknowledgement. I have some suggested changes to that format. One of them is to omit the abstract. I find it's really, you know, it's taking up valuable space. Hopefully, if you're doing your job, everything that is in the abstract, not word for word, but everything that's critical from the abstract is going to be on your poster. In the background section, I try and get people to definitely talk about the nature and magnitude of the problem. If it's a field I don't understand, I think that nature and magnitude of the problem is often the thing that will raise the significance of the poster that I'm looking for. For backgrounds, long sections of prosaic text are hard to digest. I really suggest that people use bullets. And also in the background, if you can, highlight the scientific or implementation science knowledge gap that this is addressing. You know, what's not known. I do recommend that people have a separate section on the research question. I found it fairly effective to have a highlighting box that maybe has a different background color that has your specific research question. Is doing this feasible in this population, or can we impact that? As a person walking by a poster, seeing that research question highlighted like that is another way to really draw me in. It's like, okay, I want to see that. It also helps in the specificity. What is this poster really about? It's really about the research question. Results really should be the bulk, at least two-thirds of what you're talking. you're talking about on your poster. So in terms of allocation, that's why I made it a little bit larger here. I also suggest people add in at the end, after your conclusions, what you've concluded from the data, another subheading on implications or public health or scientific significance. You know, you've concluded this. What does that mean for future directions in science? Or what does that mean that we need to pay attention to? What does it mean? What's next? I suggest omitting references. I don't find them that useful in posters the usual. The last thing is contact information. Often it's the very last thing down in the bottom of posters. And as you saw people standing around, it's really hard to actually pull some of that out. I really suggest that people, in place of that abstract or even up in your title area, to have your contact information, because often I'm looking like, oh, this is great. And I want to write down the email address or the other contact information. Where's this person from? So I suggest people bring that up to the top. I recommend, for those sections from the abstract and the additional ones, use large headings, subheadings, and open shapes to, the spatial arrangement of data on a poster is critical. You're often, grouping things by those major headings out of your abstract, but you don't have to stick with those. You can be a little bit more creative and let the content drive how you're grouping things together. Other shapes can actually be effective too. I wanted to share this one with you. I actually found this use of large open circles fairly effective in drawing my gaze, and with the changing sizes of these and grouping, it induces this natural order from, problem, approach, application. I found this to be a particularly effective one. And one of the recommendations that I often give for people early in their careers as a secret of success, and this applies to posters too, is focus, focus, focus. Really limit the presented information that you're going to put on your poster to just the critical elements that you need to understand. So you don't have to take the full, every word that's in your abstract and make it part of your poster, just the critical elements. Because, poster, as a consumer, poster reading and appreciation occurs. I have a very limited time. I have maybe 5-10 minutes to get what you're talking about. So really make it easy for your audience. There are a lot of different ways to organize things spatially in posters, and you'll see that when you go and start looking at some templates. I am not averse to using arrows to drive the viewer's attention from one section to another, because sometimes, should I be going, vertically? Should I be going horizontally? Sometimes just make it easy on people. And again, as part of that focus, 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 I know there's this desire to share all the really cool things that you've done on your poster, but overloading it is going to work against you. Save a lot of the in-depth material and the minutia for your one-to-one discussions with people. And just a little bit on presenting your poster and networking. One of the things that I think is really useful. I've met some really terrific people in presenting posters who ended up later being leaders in the field. So I have lifelong relationships with them that actually started when I was looking at their poster. It's also great later in your career when you're like, I need an expert in this. I ran into that woman who was doing social networking on that island. Like, I should look her up and bring her in. So, that those sorts of networking things that are very, very useful. Just some tips that for presenting your poster and networking. It's really helpful to prepare a 2-minute elevator pitch with the based on your poster that presents the basic questions, methods, main findings, and conclusions. You're going to be giving this talk, this 2-minute pitch, over and over and over. And so having it prepared and even writing it out and practicing it is really going to serve you well. As you're looking at people viewing your poster, just ask them, hey, would you like to know what we did and what we found? That's a great way to intro people. You know, if you have some social anxiety, you know, just like using this pitch works fairly well. You know, hi, I'm, you know, for people, you know, in who are in general, hi, I'm the author. Let me know if you have any questions. Definitely stand to the side of your poster. Don't block the viewing area because you want to leave that open for as many people as possible. Bring business cards with you or have a large font contact information on the back of your badge that you're forced to wear for security purposes that you can flip over really easy if it's not, you know, easily accessible on your poster. And definitely take advantages, as I said, of those opportunities to network. If somebody's really interested in something, you know, I said, well, you know, this is eventually going to be a paper. I sometimes will ask people, it's like, you know, would you be interested? You know, and could I suggest you as a potential reviewer in the past? It's, you know, somebody you don't have a relationship with. And so I recommend that to some of my trainees. And just the last couple of things, you know, because of COVID, kind of the world and the ways in which we present poster information talk has changed lately. So things, you know, we've had a lot of transitions to meetings that are hybrid, you know, half, you know, in person and virtual to completely virtual meetings. Some of the various formats that require changes in the way we do poster sessions have been submitting, you know, PDFs of your poster to be part of archives. One advantage there is that you can make some changes, including a little bit more text, because PDFs are zoomable if they're not image-based. A number of conferences are now having you, since you can't necessarily be there in person, do an audio recording of 3 to 5 minutes long, as if you were standing there, that elevator pitch. Some conferences have changed the format completely. Like, instead of, you know, one large poster, they're saying, now please produce 3 to 8 slides along with an audio recording. And then there are some newer formats of live digital posters, which are clickable and things like that. Those haven't been working out as very well. For these online and virtual presentations, I recommend, you know, since you can't be there in person, adding more information about you, you know, a photograph. So, you know, get people to know your face, know your name, larger contact information, and a little bit, add, you know, a brief personal statement, like what you're passionate about. Like, I'm a researcher who's studying disparities in this. Make it, you know, it's the best we can do in this virtual setting, of putting yourself into a very static presentation. For those formats that are requiring audio recording, really practice your audio several times with colleagues, get feedback, record multiple versions of it. Don't be afraid to take it to your favorite editor and edit those things back together. There have been some fantastic virtual poster hall conferences. When we send these slides out, here's one from the quantum information folks that it's really interesting how they've worked technology into that. And I suggest you guys try out that one. And lastly, you know, what do you do, you know, when you've been asked to create a poster, but you're not quite there yet, you don't yet have results. And within our consortium, at our annual meeting, which will occur probably at the end of October or early November, we're gonna ask our pilot project awardees to present a poster. And so I wanted to get across this idea of a concept poster variant. So you don't really have results to show, but you can talk about what you're trying to do, what methods are you, and a little bit more about who you are. So this concept poster variant is one in which your goal is to relay the concepts and methods of what you're planning on doing. So these have an enlarged section of the poster where it's helpful to talk about the rationale for what you're proposing. You know, what are the drivers? What are the things that you're trying to disrupt? What's better? And then, you know, what you've chosen as an option to, you know, to impinge or to learn on whatever those systems or individuals or targets are. I find these concept posters where you have a diagram of you know, the causal chain or a diagram of what you're trying to do as a, you know, a study, you know, a depiction of your study, and also expanded sections on methods, you know, how you're going to go about doing it, a little on the timeline. And I suggest in these concept poster variants that you end with, you know, what's the scientific and public health significance of what, you know, were you to find out or be able to do what you proposed, you know, that, tell me about that. So that's my 40-minute whirlwind suggestions and information that I wanted to try and get across to you that can help you learn more and produce a more effective scientific poster, and just a couple of tips on presentation. You know, in summary, always keep the audience and the viewer utmost in your mind. You know, put yourself in their shoes. What would you want to know if you knew nothing about it? How would you get that information across clearly? Take a little time to learn about some of these visual design principles. I think they will serve you well. You know, definitely model on success. Go out there, look at posters, look at, you know, like, you know, the award-winning posters to see what works for people. In photographs of conferences, look at the posters that have like the people around them. What can you notice and learn from? Like, why do you think people around there? Is the topic? Is it the way it's presented? Your colleagues and mentors are a terrific resource. You know, definitely have multiple feedback sessions on the design of your poster, on presenting them, and make sure you budget enough time to have those revisions. And lastly, you know, there are a lot of guidelines and rules out there, but, you know, some rules are really meant to be broken. Don't be, you know, don't be penned in with them. You know, breaking the rules is how innovation occurs. So I hope that was helpful. I'm glad we've got some time for some questions. Let me stop sharing.
I'll go ahead and just lead us off in the Q&A. Thank you so much, Edwin. This was so informative and helpful. And
it was kind of a fire hose.
It was wonderful. And there's a lot of positive feedback in the chat as well. So thank you. And speaking of feedback, I will launch a poll here during our Q&A so we can collect that from you and hear how you like the session. I'm just going to ask you first the second question that came in from Teresa, host at University of Minnesota, who I recognize from our Investigator Skills Development Unit. Hi. So Teresa was asking for whether you have any recommendations around incorporating branding from your institution or organization, like colors and logos, into your poster presentation, especially if those colors may be too bold or the brand fonts are not as friendly to the poster design.
Yeah, good question. You know, I think in terms of institutional branding, it is helpful. It's helpful for me to associate, you know, the investigator with where you're from. It's like, oh, you're part of that group. So in that respect, it's useful. If the color scheme is not quite right, you know, I would take some liberties with, you know, reducing contrast, reducing saturation. You know, it depends on how rigid your institution is, like if you have to get that approved or not. I do find them useful for that association of like, oh, where's that person from? Where, you know, who do I associate them with? So if that's helpful, you know, do you have to use it? No. But I think your funding agency and the institution that's sending you would probably would like to see it.
Folks are also welcome.
I would modify it. Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, welcome to unmute and ask a question if you like as well. Would anyone like to?
If people want to ask the questions themselves, Rochelle, you can just nominate them because people.
Teresa, did you have a follow up that you wanted to ask?
I like people's voices and faces.
Not a follow-up on that question, but I had another question about if you have any tips, especially coming from C2 Dream and working with early stage investigators and also being a grad student, with designing presenting these concept variant posters that, and you know, with community being involved in research and that being a big goal, how do you go about presenting and designing these in a way that is friendly to both community participants and academic audiences?
Great question. Two things there. One, I think if you have a community partner, include community voices, qualitative quotes, and photographs, you know, approved photographs of individuals, I think are fantastic at raising the visibility, raising the voice, raising the position of your community partners. If you want to share what you're doing with your audience, there's nothing. There's one suggestion is to have a lay summary, or you know, in that space where you might be doing the implications, like what's you know the lay summary, what's this mean? So you know, don't use less jargon, and involve your involve your community partners in that. You know, what language would you suggest? What would resonate with you? What would you want to know? So active, you know, for including to make it accessible to the community, involve the community in your design process. Like start develop those relationships if you don't already have them. You know, work with your co-investigators. So I think one of the goals of this initiative as a whole is to increase the standing and the role and the integration of community. So I think it's something we should all be doing.
Ijoma has a hand up. Did you want to unmute and ask
the
question, Ijoma?
Yes, thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, you sound great.
Great.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Oh, now we lost you.
Now you're muted.
Okay, there we go.
You're back.
Yeah, thank you very much for this great presentation. I'm Dr. Ijeoma Nodimo-Para calling in from Detroit, Michigan, P50 at Wayne State University School of Medicine. And I really enjoyed your presentation, got a lot of value from it. I did want to offer two quick thoughts. One being that I especially love the concept poster variant that you shared, and really expanding on that, I think will be something I would love to learn more about. And I wanted to also lift up, especially for those of us of BIPOC identity, folks who are first generation, et cetera, to really encourage the folks, especially those that are trainees, to really feel free to bring your full self, right, to the presentations of your work. I think oftentimes, for those of us who might be of minoritized groups or identities, there is a tendency to want to fit a certain box or cookie cutter way of creating the presentation of our work, whether visually, verbally, or literally. And I think that really being mindful to understand that there is space for us to bring our unique flair to these conversations and ways to do and ways of presenting the academic work is also very important. And seeing more examples of that would be really advantageous to the more diverse, as we increase our diversity of researchers and investigators, scientists, and other folks in the academic space. So I just wanted to lift that up because oftentimes I know that folks sort of feel pressure to sort of code switch in order to fit an expected way of presenting our work. And I think really being intentional and explicit in naming that we can bring our full selves and this kind of builds on the last speaker's question, to the ways that we create and present this work is really important. So I wanted to name that. And then I also wanted to ask if there'll be a part two to this wonderful presentation, because I would love to see more examples of when is this done right and the diversity of those options. You know, see like what are the different ways that we can achieve success in meeting these best practices, but then, you know, expressed in different ways, and folks can see sort of the options you have out there to do this well. So again, thank you for this great presentation, and wondering if there's a part two with accommodations for that that portion where we can see more examples of when it's done well.
Yes. There can always be a part two, because part of our job is to be responsive to the needs of the investigator development course. So we definitely can do that. And Dr. Opara, I want to second your statement about bringing your full authentic self. That's one of the reasons why I said about adding the personal statement. So I think one of the ways structural racism works is like, oh no, you need to be professional, which can chop off and limit you. So in those personal statements, I'm a first generation scientist who's studying that, bringing more of yourself to that. I highly support that, and I think it's valuable as an anti-racist activity.
And thank you for, I love that you said that. I also found that interesting that you included that. I'm going to be doing that more. I tend to just say it, but I think there's power in just putting it there, including it as part of the presentation, like the actual hard copy there, because it also gives permission for other people to bring themselves to, because that pressure is very real. And to your point around professionalism, it's like what is often coached as professionalism is more of fitting a certain sort of mold around whiteness, right? That centers whiteness. So being able to name that is important. And thank you for framing it also as part of an anti-racist way of sort of decolonizing the ways in which we do scholarly work. So I really appreciate that reflection.
Great. Dr. Franco. I think you are still muted. Yes.
Yes, give me one second. I'm not a doctor. I work on the community engagement side of research. And so my work is interconnected directly with community. And thank you, Dr. Opara, for lifting that up. Because a lot of times we are giving out this information in a very academic way. And so, I really appreciated the points in the presentation that touched on the ways that adults learned, audio, visual, hands-on. I would also like to uplift the culturally appropriate topic for giving out information. I've seen advertisements sometimes, and when they talk about homeless people, there will be a person of color on that, and we know that that's people of color are impacted greatly, but not the only people impacted. And so I think it's important to also uplift when we are using imaging and postering or any sharings of information, we want to take into consideration impacted communities, people of color, we want to show the diversity in there that matters as well. And so I would also like to be thinking about culturally appropriate approaches to posturing and to giving out information. And so that's my only add for that.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, I think one of our future activities could actually bring in our community partners together and have discussions about what are the needs, desires, and preferences in terms of as this initiative develops and has more findings, like what are the ways in which we can pull the information with the community? What's going to be most effective? How can we meet the needs, the community information needs? Because closing that loop, there are a number of things that we're trying to do in the initiative, involve community earlier in design, the decision-making process, more effective in the communications and the feedback on what we're doing, how it's going, what we should be doing. I think it'd be useful us as a group in one of our later sessions or even maybe in one of our annual workshops to engage in those discussions. I'm cognizant of the time. I want to empower people to sign off if they need to. We can stay on for a bit for any burning questions. Again, thank you. Thank you to the learners and to the staff and the development core people for joining us. This was a real pleasure. Thanks. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you so much, Edwin. And we don't need to rush away. So if anybody does have a burning question that you feel like you didn't get answered, I know there were a couple early on. I think there was one about digital presentation that I think you did a lovely job of addressing that during the talk, Edwin, but maybe additional questions. And I think there might have been one other question about the size of the poster being visible from 3 feet away I said, I went out on a limb and said, yeah, I think wherever feasible, make out all of your text readable from 3 to 5 feet, which isn't that far to think.
No, you may be, how far you are. You're probably within 3 feet. You know, if you're not on a laptop, you're probably at least 3 feet away now.
Right.
And if you aren't, think about your ergonomics.
But any other questions that we can help you with?
So I'll try and scan the chat.
Thanks. Appreciation.
Some of the things we didn't touch on, but you know, more and more, I've seen some very interesting things. People had like iPads or cell phones actually showing movies of people's stories that were attached to, you know, physically attached to posters. And was a little surprised with that. It's like, is that secure? but the different kinds of things that people have included on posters to make them a little bit more interactive and engaging have been interesting. You know, people having lift up flaps or 3D glasses. You know, you want to be careful of gimmicks, but you know, but anything you can do to draw people in is always a good thing.
I've seen a poster where the whole poster was one giant QR code. And then you had to go there to the QR code and it linked you to then the presentation. I thought that was fascinating.
I saw somebody who had a pillow with a QR code on it in the background. And it's like, I wonder if I scan that if I'm gonna go anyplace. So that's interesting. Well, again, thank you. For joining us. We'll let you know when the slides and the resources list are available, and we'll distribute that out to all the attendees, and then it will be available on our consortium website coming up in the next couple of weeks or so. Thank you, everyone.